Welcome to Chapter 20, where we'll be talking about climate change and the environment. And just to kind of give you a broad overview of the things that we'll cover, this is a rather large chapter in terms of topics. We're going to give a little background on meteorology and how that ties into climate. Let me just start off by saying the difference between weather and climate, because sometimes you might hear those used interchangeably and they are often incorrectly used. When we're talking about the weather, we're talking about current meteorological conditions at a particular station. So what is the temperature, the dew point temperature? Is it raining? What's the overcast? Is the sky overcast? Those types of things. But when we're talking about climate, we're talking about longer periods of time, such as 30-year temperature averages, maximum temperatures, minimum temperatures. So when we talk about climate versus weather, we're talking with climate a longer time scale, using some of the meteorological variables such as temperature, air pressure, dew point temperature, those types of things. But we'll get into that a little bit. But I just wanted to start off by saying we're going to be looking at climate in this particular chapter and the impacts that global climate has on the environment and what impacts the environment has on our climate. They have a two-way system. They affect each other. So for this particular chapter, we'll look at the origin of the global warming issue, and we'll look at 20th century methods to reconstruct past temperatures, the actual measurable data that we have by direct measurements, by people taking measurements of meteorological variables such as temperature, dew point temperature, those types of things, has only extended as far back as the 1880s. Nowadays, we've replaced people with machinery to take the same measurements. The planes, the jets that you fly on when you go on vacation, they're actually fully instrumented with meteorological instruments that takes temperature, pressure, those types of things. Ships have those, and you've heard of National Weather Services, and they have automated weather stations that gather information on meteorological variables. We'll also give a very broad overview of how the atmosphere works, specifically how the Earth's atmosphere, the oceans, the land, all affect climate and how climate affects those areas as well. We'll talk about the greenhouse effect. We'll talk about major greenhouse gases. Now, when you think of greenhouse gases, probably the first thing that comes to mind is carbon dioxide. We hear a lot about CO2 concentrations and how they have increased since the industrial age back in the late 1700s. Well, the actual major greenhouse gas, the big player on the scene, is not actually CO2, but water vapor. So water existing in the gaseous state. Greenhouse gas such as water vapor is a major player in terms of greenhouse gases. We'll talk about how that affects the climates. We'll talk about the interplay between the oceans and climate change there. And we'll take a look at forecasting climate change using computer simulations. I've already mentioned climate change and feedback loops, but we also, over the last few years, have a new understanding of the interplay between the oceans and the atmosphere. We'll look at new insights from the fossil record. Now, if we go looking at weather variables or climate variables before the 1870s, then we have to use things like fossil records, glaciers, sea ice, those types of things, which can tell us the concentration of certain chemical properties in the atmosphere, and from that we can infer temperatures. One of the things we'll talk about are the two different isotopes of oxygen, O16 and O18, and how that plays in giving us an idea of how temperatures were thousands of years ago. We'll talk about potential changes in river flow and sea levels based upon global climate change. We'll also talk about how that affects biological diversity. We're already seeing a lot of biological diversity being impacted, some negative impacts and some positive impacts, but we'll talk about those as well. And then we'll talk about adjusting to potential global warming. So what is the origin or the beginning of global warming issue? Well, there's not an easy answer to that. There's a lot of complex variables that we're still trying to solve to figure out why warming is increasing very dramatically. It's highly contentious, not only in the scientific community, but in the political community. The average person out on the street has some misconceptions about global warming. And so we're going to try to put a little science into this over this particular chapter. It is quite a debate that, as you'll see, is far removed from evidence based on science. So some of the questions, and these questions obviously are not all-inclusive, but here are a few questions. Why the rapid warming in the geological record? What is causing rapid warming? And we'll talk about those things here in just a few minutes. And then we'll take a look at the question, the present rate of warming. Is it unprecedented? Or at least so rare that many living things will not be able to respond successfully to it? You know, oftentimes you'll hear about that climate change is cyclical. In fact, some of the things that we'll look at later on in this chapter will show that we've had warmer periods than what we currently have. But the rate of warming is unprecedented based upon the geological evidence that we'll talk about here. How is this going to impact us and all life on Earth? And then we'll look at how can we make forecasts about it and other kinds of climate change. And then again, the main area here is based upon sustainability. What can we do to mitigate potential negative effects? Okay, we need to come up with a mitigation plan to offset those negative effects. Now, there's a possibility that burning fossil fuels might warm the climate. That, however, is not a new idea. And in fact, back in the 1800s, back in the 19th century, it was first suggested. However, there wasn't a lot of attention given to this until we got into the 20th century, specifically the first few decades. You see right there, Guy Stewart Callender actually looked at 19th century measurements of CO2 concentration and found that they were considerably lower than they were in the early 20th century. So here's a gentleman who actually started looking at data and found that CO2 concentrations were increasing compared to the previous century. And if you think about it, you know, we're sitting here as of this particular taping, it's 2016, and we're taking all these measurements and all of this data. And as you're going to learn later in this particular module, we have computer models that go out. They go out 25, 50, 75, 100 years and beyond. It'll be kind of interesting, or I think it would be interesting, in the 22nd century, how they look back on the measurements that we took in the 21st century and the models that we used back in the 21st century. It'd be kind of interesting because I have young children, 8 and 6 years old, and you know, if they live an average lifespan, the things that we talked about back in the early 21st century, will they look back upon that and kind of laugh and scoff? Or will they look at it and go, these scientists were right on. I mean, they had the right idea. Their models were dead on. They'll get to look back at that. So Callender here suggested that the difference could be attributed to the amount of CO2 added to the atmosphere from the burning of fossil fuels since the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. Keep in mind, the Industrial Revolution began in the late 1700s, continued through the 1800s. However, when he suggested this back in 1938, it was highly controversial. Well, it's highly controversial today, so that's nothing new. He was attacked by his colleagues, just as a lot of scientists today on both sides of the issue, both pro-global warming and anti-global warming, are attacked. And the thought was that the measurements taken by the 19th century scientists were inaccurate, and in fact, the scientists were incompetent. So basically, they are throwing out that data, at least that's the argument. There were few people at the beginning of the 20th century took seriously the idea that humans could actually make a change in their environment over a global level. So his calculations of increasing CO2 in the atmosphere were reevaluated, and this was the beginning of the environmental movement in the second half of the 20th century, back in the 50s and 60s. So people started looking at this, especially when we get to this IGY, the International Geophysical Year, back in 1958. They began to actually revisit this. And part of this, interest in this was sparked by how scientists saw DDT could have global impacts on the environment. So the pesticides that we use out there and how it spreads and how it can affect the entire globe. So then they started thinking, well, maybe CO2 could have an effect on such a large scale. Also during the 19th century, scientists began to understand that climate changed greatly over long periods. When you are watching the media and someone says, this particular tornado event down in Texas on this particular day was caused by global warming, that's an inaccurate statement. We cannot tell point events, weather events, not climate events, but weather events, and point it specifically to a long-term climate variable such as global warming. We have to take longer periods. Is there an increase in tornado frequency during certain periods over a 20 or 30 year period? We found that with El Nino, when scientists went back and looked at El Nino records 20, 30, and 40 years ago, they were able to attribute that there are more storms in the southern portion of the U.S. during an El Nino year. But again, they had to look at long climate periods to actually identify the cause of the storminess during El Nino events. There's times of continental glaciations. We know here in the upper Midwest, the fingers of the Ice Age actually reached down here into the Midwest. That actually helped create the fertile soils that we have here in Iowa and portions of the Midwest, was the glaciers advancing into our area and digging up minerals from subsurface. Cycles were apparent. In fact, we've looked at 100,000-year cycles divided into 20 and 40,000-year periods. So again, when we're talking about looking at climate, we're talking about looking at longer periods. So I mentioned this this particular event, the International Geophysical Year, really stirred up a lot of interest in looking at CO2 concentrations. And in fact, there was an observatory established near the top of Mauna Loa volcano over in Hawaii. And so what they ended up doing is they started measuring the concentration of CO2 in that particular area. Now, any idea why they would pick a spot out in the middle of the Pacific to measure CO2 concentration? I'll give you a moment to think about that. There was a purpose, a reason for doing this. Would you want to set up a CO2 monitoring system up in New York City or in parts of Pennsylvania or along the Gulf Coast where there are a lot of fossil fuel materials being put up into the atmosphere, that would have an effect, a local effect. So what they wanted to do is they wanted to get a global take on CO2 concentrations. So they looked at a place that was far removed from industry, and this way that provided a more accurate measurement of CO2 across the globe. And so basically they proposed that an increase in the CO2 concentration was warming the Earth. And in fact, we look at this particular graph here, the x-axis being the years and the y-axis being the CO2 concentration in terms of parts per million. So we saw back in 1958 that CO2 concentration was roughly about 318 parts per million. Now if we go to about 2013, 2014, we are now approaching 400 parts per million. So in a span of a little over 50 years, we went from roughly 315 parts per million of CO2 to now close to 400 million. There is a definite increase. Now, you'll also notice with this graph, there's a lot of up and down to this. But the overall trend, it is a sharp trend upward, a nice linear trend. That CO2 is increasing, CO2 concentration in the atmosphere is increasing with time. Now, why do you think we have these ups and downs throughout the years? And in fact, in 1 year, it goes up, goes down, goes up, goes down. And you'll recall earlier in the semester, we actually looked at a video called, I think it was the Gaia Hypothesis. And one of the charts that they actually showed was this particular chart here. And that the Earth was actually showing local increases, decreases within a year. So CO2 would begin to decrease, then it would begin to increase, decrease, increase, and so on. All within the span of a year. Well, what scientists figured out, well, let me ask you this. What on Earth? We know that when we talked about the biogeochemical cycles, one of the cycles we talked about was the carbon cycle, and CO2 is part of that. Well, we know that plants, trees, vegetation takes in CO2, and it takes in CO2 from the atmosphere. So when we begin to have full bloom, like we are now, we're beginning to have blooming of trees here in central Iowa. It's a nice sight after a long winter. The trees themselves begin to bloom. The leaves are out on the trees, and these leaves begin to take up CO2 from the atmosphere. Recall that they use that as part of the process to build sugars and carbohydrates. It's basically a fuel for them. So as the vegetation becomes plush, it takes in more CO2 from the atmosphere, and so CO2 concentrations drop. Then we hit late fall and winter, the leaves fall, they die, the trees are bare, and so then they release the CO2 back to the atmosphere. And so CO2 concentrations go up. However, and they were going up and down here, and then all of a sudden they begin to take off and increase rather rapidly. And so there is some other mechanism that is causing an increase in CO2 other than what we see with the trees taking up and giving off throughout the year. And there actually is the picture of the observatory out there in Hawaii. So, let's just spend a couple of minutes talking about how we've been able to reconstruct past temperature records. Now keep in mind, we've had instruments that have been able to record variables, weather variables such as temperature, since the late 1800s. Now here it says 1860s, that we've been able to get measurements of climate data. And some of these data are estimates. Some of those are extrapolated. Some are interpolated. However, the accuracy in the data has only, in terms of improved accuracy, has only been since the 1960s. And part of that has to do with the improved instrumentation and also the increase in instruments placed around the globe. You know, we talk about having weather instruments on buildings. You see them out on the highways. We have them on ships. We have them on planes. We have satellites that, weather satellites that were launched back in the, I think it was in 1960, that also measure weather variables such as temperature. Now, like I said, we have historical records. They go back a few centuries. A lot of these are qualitative. In other words, things that we can glean from books, newspapers, photographs, journal articles, ship's logs, traveler's diaries, and farmer's logs. But again, this is qualitative. This is not measured data. But we can actually make good use of this. And in fact, some of the best record keepers of meteorological data actually over the centuries has been monks. Okay, monks that have been over in Europe would often notice colder than normal winters, and they would keep logs of that. And then we can actually use proxy data. In other words, data that is not directly give us temperature, but from the data, but from what we test, we can infer a temperature or a climate. And some of these you've heard about before: tree rings, sediments, ice cores down in the Antarctic, fossil pollen, corals, and carbon-14. You talk about carbon-14 dating. Now, notice right here, this particular picture here shows glaciation. And you see right here, the glacier actually moves down the mountain. But by the time, and I'm not sure the time on this, I'd have to go back and look at your textbook, but notice glaciers retreating. And often, retreating glaciers are a visual or visual evidence, qualitative evidence, of a change in the climate. So let's just briefly talk a little bit about proxy climate records. Again, this is, we can look at certain things such as sediments and infer the climate from that. Now, within sediments, now we talk about sediments, we're talking about dirt, rocks, those types of things. For example, pollen is deposited on the land and stored for long periods in lakes, bogs, and pond sediments. We can look at these and infer the climate. Pollen is useful because the quantity of pollen is an indicator of the relative abundance of each of the plant species. And we know that each of the plant species, how they thrive in certain climates versus other climates, they don't thrive as well. And we can actually date the pollen, and so we can use this to construct a climate history. And so you see here a core where they dig down into the ground and they pull up sediments. And from these sediments, they can actually infer climate history. And so as you go down further and further, you're going back in history. Tree rings are another type of proxy record. Again, an indirect measure of the climate. And you see here tree rings. Let me see if I can blow this up a little bit. And so what you see here are the circles here. And so each of these circles represents a year of growth. Looks like there was some fire here too at one point. But you'll notice that as the gaps between each tree ring, as they're wider, that actually shows a climate that was very good for growth. And so you look at the types of trees that are indigenous to certain areas. If you see in one year this large growth, let's say So what are some types of trees down in southern Florida? Palm trees are an example. And so you would expect when we have warm, moist climate, for example, the trees will grow rapidly in a year's time. But then you notice later on, these circles become very concentrated. In other words, there's very little growth from year to year, as I'm pointing out down here in the bottom right of your screen. So that would indicate either cold or dry conditions or a combination of the two. And so by looking at this, we can actually see, or we can infer climate. And we can go back many thousands of years, hundreds of years actually, with this. So we look at the width, the density, and the ionic composition. So we pull some of the chemistry out of there. These are indicative of the climate. Ice cores. These things, you see these occurring, they go down to the Antarctica, and they pull out a vertical core of ice. And so polar ice and mountain glaciers have ice records that go back hundreds or thousands of years. And in fact, the oldest ice core that we have is from 800,000 years ago. And within these ice cores, they have small bubbles of air that's trapped. And so we can go into these bubbles of air, these frozen bubbles of air, and we can measure for CO2 concentration, methane levels. We can look at the O2 concentration. We can look at the nitrogen concentration, all of those things, all the way back. So again, this gives us some idea of temperature records. We look at corals. We know that corals, their exoskeletons made up of calcium carbonate, CaCO3. And this carbonate has different isotopes of oxygen. And we can use that to determine temperature of water in which the coral grew. So we can actually infer the temperature of the water indirectly from coral. Carbon-14 and sunspots. Now we know that the carbon-14 isotope is formed by cosmic radiation coming from the sun and interacting with the nitrogen present in the upper atmosphere. And this carbon-14 can then be taken up by plants, trees, shrubbery, those types of things. And then once the plants or the shrubbery becomes part of the Earth's sediment, we can actually go back in and look at the sediment and determine basically when the carbon-14 was uptaken by the sediment or by the decayed vegetation based upon the decay rate of carbon-14. The short end of this is that when we've seen increased sunspot activity going back thousands of years, we look at increased sunspot activity, that also increases the amount of cosmic radiation sent from the sun to the Earth. So an increase in carbon-14 is caused by increased solar output, which is caused by increased sunspot activity. And so what we've ended up seeing is that with increased sunspot activity, climate has tended to warm. And when we've had decreased sunspot activity, climate has cooled. And so scientists are looking at that combination of sunspots and the creation of carbon-14 to be able to infer climate. Okay, so that's the end of the proxy data that we look at to infer climate. We're going to switch gears here just a little bit. We're going to talk a little bit about the atmosphere. Like I mentioned earlier, weather is what's happening now in terms of temperature, pressure, etc. And climate is the average of these weather variables. Generally, you will see 30-year averages as kind of the minimum time frame to define as climate. And climate's also classified by the location of your particular area, how far north-south you are from the poles, and we also classify it by its moisture type. And now there are whole courses on climate, and I'm going to give you the 30-second view of climate. But if you look, when we look at climate, we're looking at in terms of different regions here. And so let's just take a look at the U.S. Now, the U.S., if you take a look basically north to south and over into the Gulf Coast, back up to the northeast, and down into the upper Mississippi Valley, you see that that is shown in this light green part of the legend. And we would refer to the climate as what we call humid subtropical. Okay, humid subtropical. That's how we would describe the climate there. And when we look at humid subtropical, we typically see that temperatures coolest in the early part of the year, and they begin to rise up to around, on average, 30 degrees Celsius or 86 degrees Fahrenheit. Again, this is a rather large area that we're talking about, and then begin to cool off here as we go into the later parts of the year. And so we're saying that the climate is typically moist and somewhat warm in the summertime. Now, if we look into the upper Ohio Valley, up into the northeast and across a large portion, we kind of fall into this. We call this humid continental. And if you look at humid continental, now continental, we're talking about land. Okay, so we're talking about moist, humid, and land-based. And we see very much like the humid tropical, although not as warm in the summer. So here we're looking at about 20 degrees Celsius, which doing the math at the top of my head would be about 68 degrees Fahrenheit, so near 70 in the middle portion. So we can look at different parts of the world and classify their climate in terms of their temperature and in terms of their moisture. Let's see. Let's look at this particular climate. Let's look at the Arctic. Okay, so this particular area here, this kind of olive green that we see up here in the far northern latitudes, they see temperatures below zero on average, and their warmest temperatures we see right there make it almost to about 32 degrees Fahrenheit or zero. And then you see the precipitation, about 40 centimeters, and there's 2.54 centimeters in an inch. So roughly, let's see, that'd be a little less than, it's hard doing these things in my head like this, but roughly a shade under 20 inches if we're looking at it in terms of inches. So relatively dry throughout most of the year and cold, but if we look at our particular area up here, the humid continental, we see that precipitation can go all the way up to 70 centimeters. Let's just do some math. Let's just use the calculator here. So 70 divided by 2.54, and we see about 28 inches there. So roughly about 28 inches in our neck of the woods that occurs typically during the summertime, and that actually occurs during the evenings typically. We talked a little bit about that. Most of our precipitation comes in the evenings during the summertime. So we can look at different places across the globe. If we look at Australia, you see a desert region here, as indicated by pink. And so deserts very warm and very high precipitation as well here, except during their wintertime, because they're in the southern hemisphere there. So temperatures begin to dip during the wintertime, begin to increase, and you see precipitation, quite a bit of precipitation, even though it's shown as a desert-type region. So like I said, you can look at these different areas here, but this is generally what we call the climate in these particular areas. Now, the atmosphere, we know that the atmosphere is comprised of gases such as nitrogen, oxygen, argon, CO2, water vapor, and other trace amounts of gases. But our atmosphere is basically held in place by gravity and pushed upward by thermal energy. So the atmosphere is a dynamic system. In other words, it's constantly changing. You know, we talk about wait 5 minutes and the weather will change here in Iowa. Well, there's somewhat truth there because of our atmosphere constantly changing. Now, climate is always changing because it's a vast chemically active system. It gets started by sunlight, and this sunlight is and affected by high energy compounds emitted by living things. So you see right there oxygen, methane, and CO2. And our climate is also fueled by what we put out in terms of industrial waste and agricultural activities. And we talked about, especially in the biogeochemical areas, we talked about reservoirs for complex chemical reactions, changing from day to night and with the chemical elements available. Now we'll spend just a few minutes talking about the vertical structure of the atmosphere. It has several different layers. The layers where weather occurs is the troposphere. And in the troposphere, we'll just go down to the next slide here. So the troposphere is this region from the ground up to roughly 10 kilometers. Now this changes depending upon the temperature structure, but typically the troposphere is from the ground up to about 10 kilometers or roughly 6 miles, 6.1 miles up. And again, like I said, that changes from day to day. And then this region called the tropopause is the upward boundary, or the upper, you can think of it as a lid on top of the troposphere. Now notice here, this particular graph, we have temperature versus height above the Earth. And on average, the temperature in the troposphere decreases with height. However, when you get to the tropopause and then above the tropopause, well, before I go any further, I should mention here that the weather that occurs in the troposphere. So the region below the tropopause here is where weather occurs. Now, once we get above that, we get into this region called the stratosphere. Notice temperature begins to increase rather rapidly. So now we're up to about 55, or let's just make the math easy on me here, 50 kilometers, which is roughly about 30 miles above us. We see temperatures approaching 0 degrees Celsius. So we have rapid warming here in the stratosphere. And then notice temperature begins to even out, and this region between where the temperature increases and begins to even out is what we call the stratopause. That is the lid for the stratosphere. So we've got these different layers, the troposphere, the stratosphere, the mesosphere, where temperature begins to decrease rapidly again, and then above that we have the thermosphere. Now I'm not interested in you memorizing all of this, but I just want you to be aware that there are different layers, vertical layers of the atmosphere based upon temperature structure, okay? Based upon temperature structure. You can also classify the atmosphere based upon its electrical magnetic properties as well, but for what we're working with in this particular course, we're going to just look at the layers of the atmosphere based upon temperature. Also notice the concentration of ozone here. You have small amounts of ozone near the surface, but most of the ozone, O3, is produced up in the stratosphere. So where you have molecular oxygen, O2, and single molecule of oxygen, they can combine to form O3, which is ozone. And it's fortunate that we have the greatest amount of ozone up in the stratosphere, because the ozone acts as a protector of the ultraviolet radiation coming in from the sun. Ultraviolet radiation is highly energetic, and shortwave energy from the sun, typically between 0.3 and roughly between 0.2 and 0.4 microns. So very shortwave, strong energy from the sun is absorbed by ozone. So it's important that we have a healthy ozone layer up there. Now, processes in the atmosphere, we generally look at them in terms of pressure, temperature, and water vapor content. When we talk about pressure, it's the force per unit area. In other words, it's the force exerted by the molecules of nitrogen, oxygen, argon, CO2, water vapor. So if you were to think about taking a textbook and putting on top of your head, take your textbook, put it on top of your head, the textbook is actually exerting pressure. It's exerting a force, okay, the force of the book, over the unit area of your head. So that's how we define pressure, but in the atmosphere, we look at all the molecules above our head into the atmosphere. And both the density and the pressure decreases as we go up in altitude. And when we start talking about, if you're watching the 6 o'clock weather or 11 o'clock weather, 10 o'clock weather, I guess, they'll talk about low pressure and high pressure. Just know that low pressure systems bring inclement weather, such as clouds, rain, thunderstorms. And if your area is under high pressure, then that typically means clear skies, nice areas of sunshine. Now, temperature is actually the measure of the average speed of molecular motion. Okay, so if you have molecules moving quickly, more quickly, then the temperature increases. And you remember the example back in elementary school. You take your hands and rub together, trying to warm up your hands when it's cold. Well, the molecules of your hands, as you begin to pass them from each hand to hand here, begin to become more energetic, which increases the amount of energy being produced. And so your hands become warmer. Water vapor, we said, is basically water in a gaseous state. And that is a variable gas. In other words, it's not a permanent gas like nitrogen and oxygen, but it is a variable gas and actually varies anywhere from 1 to 4%. Can you list the biggest source of water vapor for Iowa? Where do you think the largest source of water vapor for Iowa occurs? Let me give you a hint. It's about 1,000 miles to our south. It is the Gulf of Mexico. So when you begin to have the ocean, you have shortwave radiation from the sun begins to cause evaporation. We're loading up the atmosphere with water vapor. It's transferred into Iowa in the Midwest through southerly winds. And so when we get our winds coming in from the south, which is generally during the summertime and parts of spring and early fall, we have increased amounts of moisture or water vapor. And recall earlier I said water vapor is a very strong greenhouse gas. Now the atmosphere, actually it's not stagnant, it moves. And part of that has to do with the Earth's rotation, but a lot of it has to do with the differential heating. In other words, the difference in energy received at the poles versus the amount of energy received from the sun at the equator. And we know that a lot of energy, there's more energy received at the equator than there is at the poles, North Pole and South Pole. And so the atmosphere is always in a process of trying to equalize this energy imbalance. And so this differential heating, more heating occurring at the equator versus the poles, begins to move. That's how we begin to form the movement of wind. And we begin to have, I'll talk about this here in just a little bit. I don't want to get ahead of myself here. But basically these provide global wind patterns. In fact, let's just take a look. I think there's a, yes, right here. And so because of the differential heating caused at 0 degrees latitude, the equator, and the poles, we begin to get all these different types of wind systems. Now, what you're looking at right here, let's just concentrate on the blue inner circle. and these are the horizontal winds. So typically in our area here, the prevailing winds are from the southwest. Now, when we talk about wind direction, we're talking about the direction the wind is coming from, not blowing to. And so this arrow indicates winds coming in from the southwest, moving to the northeast. We call this a southwest wind. And in fact, most of the U.S. up here is in what we call these prevailing westerlies, southwest, westerly type winds. Now we get up into the equatorial region, the winds are mainly out of the east. And so we call these the easterlies. When we get down here along the Gulf Coast, all the way through Mexico, Central America, and portions of South America, we have what we call these trade winds. These are the northeast trade winds. These winds are coming in from the northeast. Now we go below the equator, and notice what happens here. We have trade winds from 0 to 30 degrees south. And these winds are coming in from the southeast. So we call these the southeast trade winds. Now notice what happens when the northeast trade winds and the southeast trade winds meet. What happens? Well, there's one of two things that can happen. Either it goes down into the ocean, and you see these big holes in the ocean, which, by the way, you don't, or they move upward. And so you begin to see this vertical circulation of air. So as these trade winds, the southeast trade wind meets here with the northeast trade wind at the equatorial region, you begin to get upward moving air. And the warm air begins to rise, and it begins to move equatorward and begins to sink. And so you have all these different circulations that are occurring throughout the entire Earth. And so this is just basically a very simplified version. But what I want you to realize is that in this particular case, the energy imbalances from the equatorial regions up to the polar regions is a cause of wind and the transfer of energy from the equator to the poles. So, what makes the Earth warm? Well, the big driver is energy from the sun. You know, if we're going to talk about global warming, we need to talk a little bit about how the Earth is warmed. Again, these are very simplified versions. There are whole courses, in fact, courses that I teach, that talks about radiation and energy and those types of things. But it's just about all of our energy comes from the sun. The sun emits energy in a wide range of what we call electromagnetic radiation. Now, I'm going to call your attention here to this ruler here on the right-hand side, what I'm outlining here with the mouse. And so we're looking at the wavelengths. In other words, the length. In fact, let me just go ahead and draw this up. It'll be easier if I just do this. So when we talk about wavelengths, I'm drawing this with a mouse, so it's a little tough. Notice that we have these crests where it begins to bow up, and troughs, where they begin to bow down. So crest, troughs, crest, and troughs. So if we take and measure from the crest of this particular wave here, you can think of this just like a jump rope. If you've ever held a jump rope with a friend and you start shaking that jump rope up and down, you begin to get these waves. So from the crest of this wave to the crest of this wave is one wavelength. That's the symbol for wavelength there. So one wavelength. We can also look at from the base of one trough to the base of this trough is one wavelength. Now what if I really begin to, what happens when you begin to shake the rope between you and your friend a lot faster? Well, you get a bunch of smaller wavelengths, like this. Okay. So the distance from one crest to the next is shorter. So this is one wavelength, but it's shorter. And these shorter wavelengths indicate stronger energy or higher intensity of energy. When the sun emits its electromagnetic radiation, it emits it in what we call these short waves. And these short wave radiation is highly energetic. Long wave radiation is the radiation that's emitted from the Earth or anything on the Earth. So it's not as energetic. So again, when we start looking at the wavelengths getting really smaller here. These are micrometers. These, if you were to look at a micrometer, it's thinner than the diameter of your hair. If you were to pluck one hair, it's even thinner than that. But notice here that as we get shorter and shorter wavelengths, the energy, such as X-rays, gamma rays, these are things that are all dangerous to us. And then we get to this region called ultraviolet. And you'll notice that we have from 0.4 microns to 0.7. This range here from 0.4 to 0.7 is what we call the visible wavelength. Okay, these are colors that we see. And so we see that the violet color here, the ultraviolet, is shorter wavelength compared to infrared. And you see that the wavelength of red is 0.7 microns. The wavelength of violet is 0.4. But from 0.4 to 0.7, this is the area that our eyes can see. We call this the visible part of the electromagnetic spectrum. So basically what I want you to get out of this is that with sunlight, it's shortwave, highly energetic radiation. Shortwave energy, which is from the Earth, our bodies emit long-wave radiation. That is less energetic. And so when we talk about most of the radiation reaching the Earth, it tends to be anyway from 1 to out here, shorter wavelengths. Notice that ozone actually picks off a lot of this radiation in shorter wavelengths. And it's a good thing because our biology cannot handle that much energy. It causes damage to our cells, can lead to cancer. So you see here, this particular graphic is the temperature of the sun, about 6,000 degrees Celsius, and the temperature of the Earth is 15 degrees Celsius. And so there is this relationship between energy and temperature. Obviously, the Earth is a lot cooler on average. So the average temperature of the Earth, 15 degrees Celsius. Let's see, which would place that, let's see, I'm doing the math in my head here again. So somewhere between, right about 59 degrees Fahrenheit. So on average, the average temperature of the Earth is about 59 degrees Fahrenheit. Here, the sun's hot, okay? It's almost 6,000 degrees Celsius versus 15. So the sun, very warm, puts out these short waves of energy that you see right here. Okay, highly energetic, and most of it in the visible range from 0.4 to 0.7. And the Earth and everything on the Earth typically is anywhere from about 4 microns up to about 20 microns. So longer wavelengths here. We can look at this particular chart here. If we look at wavelength versus the amount of energy in terms of watts per meter squared per micron, you see the sun here is much more energetic, and its highest energy is at shorter wavelengths compared to the Earth. So again, wavelength here of about 0.1 micron, and the energy from the sun emitted in that 0.4 to 0.7 region right here, which is where most of the energy is emitted. In other words, 10 to the 7 watts per meter squared per micron of energy. But the sun emits most of its energy at longer wavelengths, right around 10 microns. And this is all in the infrared part of the spectrum. It's the part that we cannot see. Your body is radiating away infrared energy, but we cannot see this. I've often heard that there's some suggestion that pets, such as dog and cats, they see in the infrared infrared portion of the electromagnetic spectrum, not the visible as we see. So if that's the case, the energy that we're radiating, they can see that. If you ever watch the old series Star Trek The Next Generation, you remember Geordi LaForge. He had the visor because he was blind, but his visor could only see in infrared. So if you recall that, that gives you a bit of an idea. So, under average conditions, the Earth's atmosphere actually reflects about 30% of the energy coming in from the sun. It absorbs about 25%. And so what happens to the remaining 45%? It gets to the surface. And then it radiates back to the atmosphere or into outer space. And so if you look at this part of the Earth, energy coming in from the sun, about 30% of it's reflected back off. According to this, about 25% of it's absorbed, and then the remaining 45% radiates back into the atmosphere, which is very near to the surface of the Earth, or back out into space. And in that particular model, that keeps our temperature on average across the globe about 59 degrees Fahrenheit. And so you see this here, just talking about that. Now, also, the Earth not only absorbs energy from the sun, but the Earth also emits energy. And we talked about that being in the infrared area, long-wave radiation. About 70% of the heat is lost to space from both the atmosphere and the surface of the Earth. You do have some heat reabsorbed by the Earth from greenhouse gases such as CO2, methane, and other types of greenhouse gases, water vapor. I'm a little surprised they don't have water vapor here. But what we're talking about with this particular graphic here is an exchange of energy between the sun and the Earth. Okay, so you have a little bit of an idea of climate, a little bit on energy exchange. Let's talk about some causes for climate change. There is this theory, this cycle called the Milankovitch cycle, which explains why climate changes. And if you think, you ever had those things called weebles, or what do they call, weebles wobble, but they don't fall down? Boy, I'm really dating myself here. If not, you can, let's go see if we can find a weeble here on YouTube, because this will make a little bit more sense. But they don't fall down. Oh, here we go. Boy, yeah, 1970s. Check this out.
Kids pretend they're flying into Weeble Airport. Next day, they play around the Weeble Cottage. Or if it's real nice, they go out to the Weeble Marina and go fishing. Hey, hey, look at me and Weeble.
So notice how they're spinning around, but they're also wobbling. Well, the Earth actually does that as well.
When we look at the Milankovitch cycles, we're going to be studying long-term climate factors as a result of Earth motions. When we look at eccentricity here, we're talking about the shape of the Earth's orbit. When we study obliquity, we're looking at the axial tilt. And when we look at the direction of the axis change, in this case, the precession, it's really looking at the wobble of where the North Pole is pointing, that these cycles, that these variations change the amount of solar energy reaching the Earth. These are called Milankovitch cycles. They are named after a Serbian mathematician named Milutin Milankovitch, who used them to explain an advanced retreat of polar ice caps. Essentially, we're looking at glacial ice ages. Many scientists believe that these play a critical role in Earth's climate. In this activity, you're going to learn about eccentricity, obliquity, and precession, and how they change through time. You'll also learn how these changes influence the Earth's climate. So, moving on. So, eccentricity is a measure of how elliptical an orbit is. A planet's closest approach to the Sun is what we call perihelion, and its furthest distance is what we call aphelion. So, perihelion, closest distance, aphelion, furthest distance. The eccentricity is a measure of how different these are. So it's kind of a ratio. It's aphelion minus perihelion divided by aphelion plus perihelion. So when E is equal to zero, the orbit is circular, perfectly circular. As E gets close to one, the orbit becomes more elongated. When E is greater than zero, note that the Sun is not the center of the ellipse. So this will be our Sun, and this would be an example of Earth. Here we have perihelion, here we have aphelion. So Earth's eccentricity here, if I look at my values here, I can calculate it, but it's actually provided on the screen, so I'll just read it. Eccentricity of the Earth is 0.017. The eccentricity of Mars is 0.094. And the eccentricity of Pluto is 0.244. So you'll see that the Earth's orbit, or in this case, the eccentric value, is actually it's fairly circular, where Mars is a little bit more eccentric and Pluto's is actually the most eccentric of all the planets, even though it's been demoted as the dwarf planet. So eccentricity cycles. These eccentricity cycles follow about a 100,000-year cycle. The eccentricities vary from a minimum of 0.0005 to a maximum E value of 0.0607. The larger the eccentricity, the greater the difference in solar radiation that reaches the Earth at perihelion versus aphelion. At its current value of E equals 0.017, this difference is 6.7%. It is thought that over the long term, these changes can affect Earth's climate. So a little clearer animation here from Mankiewicz cycle is that over a period of about 100,000 years, the shape of the Earth's orbit gradually changes from circular to elliptical. And that's what we're seeing here. Notice, perihelion and aphelion, this number, this value is going to change, so therefore so does the E value over large scales of time. So the second of the Milankovitch cycles involves obliquity. Obliquity refers to the tilt of the Earth's axis relative to the plane of its orbit. This tilt currently is 23.5 degrees. In December, the axis is tilted away from the Sun. The northern hemisphere receives energy from the Sun at a more oblique angle and thus results in winter. In June, the axis is tilted towards the Sun. And therefore, the northern hemisphere is receiving much more energy because it has a less of an angle in which it's angled at. In other words, it's much more direct. And this results in summer weather. If the obliquity were zero, there would be no seasons. It would be like one homogeneous day, calendar year. Distance from the Sun is not a factor when determining seasons. So let's look at obliquity. If this would be energy from the Sun, we could look at this, and if we notice that in December, if this were 23.5, here's our axial tilt, southern hemispheres in the summer, northern hemisphere based on this picture, would be in winter, and therefore 6 months later, different location in its orbit, the northern hemisphere is tilted towards the Sun, so it's in summer, and the southern hemisphere is tilted away, therefore it's in winter. So looking at this, the time of year, and based on the Earth's axial tilt, as it travels or orbits the Sun, we're getting changes in its location, therefore we're going to get changes in the directness of sunlight, which is what we call insolation. So here we see the obliquity cycles. The obliquity for the Earth's orbit follows a roughly 40,000-year cycle. This variation is going to be around, let's just say, around 21 degrees to about 24.5 degrees. The larger the obliquity, the greater the difference in seasonal temperatures. So in this animation, the obliquity is exaggerated, just to kind of show you what's happening with this axial tilt change. So if I interpret this graph here, these ebbs and flows, this up and down oscillatory pattern, really the obliquity is going to change over large periods of time. And we can see how they reach these maximums and minimums. The minimum here is 24,000, and the maximum, so here's my minimum, and here's my maximum in 12,000-year increments. So here we can view the Milankovitch cycle here with the present axial tilt. Oop, I don't know what just happened. Let me reset that. So at present, Earth's axis tilts with respect to the plane of its orbit at 23.5 degrees. So we know this much. And as we change throughout the course of the year. The high-latitude regions receive less solar energy than low-latitude regions based on the directness of sunlight. So we have seasons because the axial tilt is not perpendicular to the plane of orbit. Because of this, the amount of sunlight received in an area varies throughout the year. So this is showing you the axial tilt in the Earth's relative location. So Milankovitch calculated that the angle varies between, you know, this 21, 22 degrees and 24.5 degrees in roughly 40,000 year increments. So the amount of sunlight at a given point is going to vary over time as well. And that's a key feature here, that any one individual Milankovitch cycle is going to have its own timeline, but when you put them all together, they will all coincide together at large-scale time increments that lead to climate-changing factors. So let's look here at the last one. And the last of the Milankovitch cycles is called precession. The Earth wobbles like a spinning top, which is running down. This wobble follows roughly a 20 to 25,000 year cycle. The Earth's axis now points at Polaris, our North Star. But every 13,000 years, right, halfway through its total cycle, it points toward the star Vega. So precession is caused by the gravitational effects of both the Sun and the Moon. So we're kind of playing this like tug of war of gravity. So if I look here at these precessional values, these oscillations here, you're going to see this alternating feature and factor here. And we could calculate this in terms of times a year. So my x-axis here is time, and this would be my precession value. But if I look at this picture, I'm simply trying to view that the North Pole is going to be pointed at different locations in the night sky. Therefore, all total, when you put all of these Milankovitch cycles together, you're going to get these compounding effects, particularly when they all constructively interfere with all of their patterns, to where they all influence and decrease the amount of sunlight energy reaching the Earth's surface. So the Milankovitch cycle. So the third part, precession, this axis, this wobble like a top, is at roughly 25,000 year increments. This determines the timing of the seasons relative to the position of the Earth along its orbit. So really what we're looking at here is this changing feature, right, in about 25,000 year increments. And it's going to be pointed at currently Polaris, and in 13-ish thousand years, it's going to be pointed at Vega. And that changes the timing of the seasons. So the precession and eccentricity. So winter in the northern hemisphere at perihelion, there's more total energy from the sun, right? So this would be, the southern hemisphere summer, and the northern hemisphere would be winter, right? Winter in the northern hemisphere. So precession changes the direction of tilt of the Earth's axis relative to aphelion and perihelion. Currently, the northern hemisphere experiences winter when the Earth is closest to the sun. 13,000 years ago, winter occurred in the northern hemisphere when it was furthest from the sun. So since most of Earth's landmass in the northern hemisphere, these changes are believed to have an effect on the accumulation of ice and snow at the poles and may play a role in the Earth's long-term climatic cycles and ice ages. So really, once again, we look at these in December, here's where it's located. In June, here's where it's located. But 13,000 years ago, right, when our precession value was different, notice that these change, that here's the summer in the northern hemisphere at perihelion, and this would have been winter in the northern hemisphere at perihelion. So 13,000 years ago, look at this, our northern pole was actually pointed toward Vega and not at where it is currently pointing at, at Polaris. So it changes the timing of the winter in the northern hemisphere, having a greater land mass than water mass. It just changes how the planet behaves and responds to incoming solar radiation. So let's look at this graphically. Insolation and climate. The Milankovitch cycles result in long-term fluctuations in the energy that reaches the Earth. There is good evidence that these changes in insolation have influenced the Earth's past climate. However, alone, these changes are insufficient to explain past climate. Other complex feedback effects are also important, and we can identify positive and negative types of feedbacks. The two graphs on the right show changes in insolation at 65 degree north latitude and global temperature difference from modern estimates using deuterium isotopes from the Vostok Antarctic ice cores. So if I look here, where I see these ebbs and flows, these peaks and valleys of where I find high and low temperatures, they also correspond to insulation values, right, in watts per meter squared. So where I get this higher value of insulation, I get these higher values of temperature, right? And that should make sense, right? And they're close. They may not be perfect, but they're pretty darn close, that they coincide with one another. But when you put these all together, it's the data you're looking at. You're looking at all these Milankovitch cycles all together can add up to causing long-term, large-scale climate change.
And I just want to briefly touch on solar cycles. The sun, like we said, goes through cycles, sometimes hotter, sometimes cooler. And this has been documented by differing amounts of isotopes that are trapped in glacial ice. And the variability of the solar input of energy explains some of the climate variability, but not all. Okay, let's spend just a couple of minutes talking about how the Earth's atmosphere, the Earth's oceans, and the land affect climate. Again, we're just trying to get a handle on how temperatures increase, decrease based upon various parameters that are present. So the transparency of the atmosphere, especially to shortwave radiation coming in from the sun in that 0.4 to 0.7 micron region, basically the atmosphere is transparent to it. So that shortwave energy comes right through the atmosphere. Very little of it's absorbed by any of the atmospheric gases. And so it goes directly to the Earth's surface. Now, the Earth's surface also emits energy, and we talked about that being in the long wave spectrum from about 4 microns out to about 20. We do have dust and other types of small particulate matter, which we call aerosols, that absorb light. Volcanoes, forest fires, and farming put dust into the atmosphere. Chemical and physical composition of the atmosphere can make it warmer or cooler. Sulfur dioxide present in the atmosphere can actually help to reflect quite a bit of the sun's incoming shortwave radiation. So those are things that we need to take into account as well, having an impact. The surface of the Earth and something called albedo. Albedo is simply the amount of reflectivity of a particular surface. So when we look at the Earth as a whole, and we mentioned this a few minutes ago, about 30% of the incoming shortwave radiation from the sun is being reflected back out into space. And clouds, depending upon how thick they are and the type of clouds, can reflect anywhere from about half to almost all of the sunlight coming in from the sun. Fresh snow can have an albedo. Now here it says 85%, but fresh snow actually can have an albedo up to 95%. Think about it. You're walking along the sidewalk, you've just had a fresh snow, the sun's out, and you basically need sunglasses to be able to walk out there because about 95% of that shortwave radiation, that visible light coming in from the sun, is reflected back out toward our eyes. You see glacial ice there anywhere from 20 to 40%. A pine forest only reflects about 10%. Dark rock reflects very little. Dry sand reflects about 40% of the incoming shortwave radiation. And then a grass-covered meadow, only about 15%. So again, keep in mind that temperature is impacted by how much of the shortwave radiation is being absorbed by an object. If you have snow, only about 15% of that shortwave radiation is being absorbed. And so most of that energy from the sun, especially with fresh snow, is being reflected back off into space. So very little of it's being used to heat the Earth's surface. Whereas if you look at a pine forest, the forest itself is absorbing almost 90% of that incoming shortwave radiation. So albedo plays a role in terms of energy balance and temperatures. The roughness of the Earth's surface also affects the atmosphere. If you look at a completely smooth surface, air flows very smoothly across it without any ripples. We call this a laminar flow, which is basically smooth flow of air. However, especially over mountainous areas, you have air becoming turbulent because it's interacting with the terrain and it can cause the air to spin, rotate, reverse, and do all kinds of interesting things. Turbulent air, okay, gives up some of its energy, and that energy is turned into heat, which also affects the weather above. Forests, we said, are a much rougher surface than smooth rock or glaciers. So in this way, too, vegetation affects weather and climate as well. Now, just spend a moment here talking about the chemistry of life and how that affects the atmosphere. A planet with water vapor, which Earth is, liquid water, frozen water, and living things has a much more complex energy exchange system. Now, if you compare that to a lifeless, waterless planet, which lacks the complex energy exchange system, you're going to get a different type of setup. I mean, you can look at the very thin atmosphere of Mars compared to a rather complex atmosphere that we have here on Earth. This is just one reason of many why it is difficult to forecast climate change, because our Earth is very dynamic. It changes constantly. Okay, let's get to this thing called the greenhouse effect. Many of you have heard about this for years. Let's just talk about it here. Gases in the atmosphere has its own absorption spectrum. In other words, gases can absorb with varying degrees of success shortwave radiation from the sun and longwave radiation from the Earth. So if you look at gases, there are some gases such as CO2 and water vapor. They're very good at absorbing infrared energy. Now, keep in mind, when I'm talking about infrared energy, I'm talking about energy that is emitted by the Earth or objects on the Earth. So the energy that we give off, the energy that is absorbed at the Earth's surface from the sun is given off as long wave or infrared energy. So it emits that energy, and this is what helps to increase the temperature of the Earth's surface. Now think about this. If we had no atmosphere present, what would happen is that the shortwave radiation from the sun would come in, contact the Earth's surface, it would absorb, and then the Earth would give off. It would give off that energy without anything in the atmosphere to absorb it. So here's a rather complex type of, I mean, it's not that complex. Let's just spend a little time talking about this. So you see the Earth's surface here in blue, and you see the atmosphere. And within the atmosphere, keep in mind, we've got nitrogen. About 78% of the volume is nitrogen, 20% roughly oxygen. And then you've got gases, trace gases such as CO2. We have water vapor, methane, all what we call greenhouse gases. So the sun emits the shortwave radiation. The shortwave radiation, we said, from the sun goes right through the atmosphere, has no problem penetrating the atmosphere and going right into the Earth's surface. Now the Earth itself also emits and absorbs energy. So the Earth is absorbing the shortwave radiation from the sun, but now the Earth also emits energy as well. You see some of this. So notice the waves here are longer. That means long-wave radiation or infrared radiation that is given off into space. Now notice, it looks like you've got a mess in here, but notice here what's happening is that the Earth is emitting short or long wave radiation, and it's being absorbed by different gases in the atmosphere. Okay? And so what is happening is these gases in the atmosphere, such as CO2, such as methane, such as water vapor, it absorbs that energy and emits it back to the Earth. And so some gases in the atmosphere acts as an absorber or a blanket to keep this long wave energy from escaping off into the Earth's atmosphere. Okay, now just think about that here for just a little bit. There's an exchange of energy here. Now, some of that long-wave radiation can pass out back off into space. Now, the greenhouse effect itself, it's a natural phenomenon. You see some of the major greenhouse gases there. We've talked about them. Oh, yes, oxides of nitrogen, the N2O, and chlorofluorocarbons. Chlorofluorocarbons can exist in the atmosphere for over a century, and they are a greenhouse gas. A lot of those chlorofluorocarbons, a lot of those were emitted back in the 70s and 60s, back in the 1960s and 1970s, when CFCs were used as a propellant in underarm deodorant, hairspray, and those types of things. Since then, we've eliminated a lot of the CFCs. They're no longer being used as propellants. Also, we're phasing out CFCs used as refrigerant for air conditioners as well. But notice right here, now we're looking at wavelengths. We're looking at long wavelengths. They're going from 4 microns to up around 20. And so notice here, we talk about the amount of energy, the relative intensity of energy being emitted. And the largest amount of energy is right around 10 microns, between 8 and 12. And then you see these, what we call absorption bands, such as water vapor and carbon dioxide. And anything that emits energy in this 12 to 16 micron band here, any energy emitted from the Earth's surface or from anything on the Earth's surface is absorbed by water vapor, CO2, methane, some oxides of nitrogen, CFCs. But notice here, what do you notice here between 8 and 12 microns? Very little greenhouse gases are being absorbed by the atmosphere. You see some CFCs and ozone are absorbed here, but very little of the energy being radiated from the Earth's surface is being captured by the atmosphere. So anything emitting energy from 8 to 12, that energy is leaving the Earth's surface and going off into space. Now, there is a way we can close this window, this atmospheric window. Notice here that anything that's emitted from 12 to 16 microns is being absorbed by the atmosphere and then being emitted back down to the Earth's surface. It's what helps keep the Earth warm. But there's an area here between 8 and 12 microns where any energy, and in fact the largest amount of energy you see right here, if we look at relative intensity, the highest peak is right around 10 microns. And so most of the items on the Earth's surface emit their energy at about 10 microns. However, if you get clouds moving into your area, clouds are a great absorber of infrared energy being emitted. So if you happen to move clouds, the clouds can basically close this atmospheric window. And that's why, part of the reason why, on cold January nights, when the skies are clear, there are no clouds present, what little energy we have gained from the sun that we've absorbed on the Earth's surface, almost all of that energy is let out into space. However, on cloudy nights in January, when it's really cold, the temperatures won't drop as much because whatever energy is being emitted from the Earth's surface is being absorbed by the clouds, and the clouds are emitting energy back to the Earth's surface. So clouds are a feature that can close this gap between 8 and 12 microns. It's probably more than you wanted to know. Oh, so this particular one, we talk about the type of major greenhouse gases, the relative contribution to global warming, to the greenhouse effect. You see right here, the biggest one in terms of trace gases is CO2. it contributes about 50 to 60%, and then you see the growth rate in percent by year. So CO2 is increasing by about 0.3 to 0.5% per year. Another big one. So if you take CFCs, methane, ozone, nitrous oxide, they contribute about 40 to 45%, with the rest of it coming from CO2. So these are some in terms of trace gases. Now, I wish they would have shown water vapor, because that is a big one for what we've got here. So when you're talking about gases, water vapor and CO2 are the big ones. So really, just thinking about all of this, you can think of it in terms of, if you total up all the reflected solar radiation and the outgoing infrared radiation, this balances with the energy arriving from the sun. We saw the exchange of energy, specifically infrared radiation, the long wave radiation, is shared or transferred back and forth between the atmosphere, oceans, ice, and solid surfaces. But if we look at it in terms of infrared energy absorbed compared to what is absorbed from the sun, we can estimate that what we absorb in terms of shortwave radiation is about 2 times the amount of shortwave energy coming in from the sun. So it really is the longwave radiation and the greenhouse gases in the atmosphere that are the drivers of our warming here on Earth. Now, if we look at the greenhouse gases, the fact that they are present in our atmosphere, they keep us on average about 33 degrees Celsius warmer than it would be otherwise. So, for instance, to put that in terms of degrees Fahrenheit, without an atmosphere, we would be, our average global temperature would be about 0 degrees Fahrenheit, compared to 59 degrees Fahrenheit with the atmosphere, with greenhouse gases. It does perform other important services as well, such as the strong downward emission of the infrared energy from the greenhouse effect. This allows the land to cool much faster at night and warm much more quickly during the day. That would be without the infrared energy. So you would cool much more quickly at night and warm much more quickly during the day. So that would be the result of the 59 degree Fahrenheit difference without the infrared energy by the greenhouse gases, when I was saying it would be 0 degrees Fahrenheit on average without the infrared energy from the greenhouse gases. This greenhouse gas effect in the atmosphere helps to moderate the temperatures and keep them much more relatively comfortable levels. Not the greenhouse effect itself, but the changes in greenhouse gases, that is what has become a concern. So greenhouse gases themselves are very good for us. It helps to keep our climate moderate, but it's the change in concentration of these greenhouse gases that are the concern for us. When we look at the oceans and climate change, it's very complex. It changes constantly, and it's an ongoing relationship between the oceans and the atmosphere. Water itself has the largest ability, or the highest ability, to store heat of any other type of surface that we have on the Earth. And keep in mind, 2/3 of the Earth is made up of large oceans. So there's a large heat reservoir in the oceans. But it takes time for it to absorb, and also takes time for it to release. Keep in mind, all oceans also, if we look back at the biogeochemical cycle, specifically carbon, oceans do a good job of absorbing dissolved CO2. So as CO2 increases in the atmosphere, it will also increase in the oceans, which can create issues to living organisms. that we have to keep in mind as well. So it does impact negatively the biodiversity in the oceans as well. Okay, so at this point, we're going to transition over into looking at computer models to forecast future states of the climate. One type of model that we look at is called the general circulation model. And this general circulation model includes the winds of the earth, the currents of the oceans. It includes a lot of parameters within this model. The atmosphere itself is divided into these rectangular solids. They each extend a few kilometers into the atmosphere and several kilometers north or south. So it has a horizontal and vertical resolution. For each of them, the flux of energy, in other words, the change of energy coming into and out, and the matter is calculated to each surrounding cell. There's something called a steady state model, and this cannot account for randomness in the model. The models themselves have not been validated adequately. There's things that we cannot account for within these models. However, they are widely used, and a lot of the current conclusions about climate change are based on these forecasts. So the models, like I said, we can't account for everything in nature with these models, but it does give us a general idea of how things could change into the future.
Hi, I'm Richard Sedlock. Welcome to the Green Ninja course on climate science. In episode 21, we investigate how scientists use analytical models to evaluate climate and possible climate change. Here's the concept map of Earth's climate system that I introduced in episode 4. Even though the map is far from complete, it clearly shows the staggering complexity of Earth's climate system. How can we predict or project the climate of the future for so complex a system? We use global climate models, mathematical representations of physical processes and components of the Earth's climate system. Many types of models have been developed, but the most sophisticated are general circulation models, or GCMs. The goal of a general circulation model is to take local interactions of climate components and infer from them how the climate system will respond to changes on a regional or global scale. It's an immense conceptual design and computation challenge. Many of the most brilliant scientific minds on the planet are working on it, as are some of the world's largest computing facilities. As in any scientific undertaking, climate modeling makes mistakes and learns from them. Climate modelers improve their procedures. Modern climate models include more features than earlier ones. By this point, GCMs do a very satisfactory job of simulating climate in the recent past. Later, we'll see evidence for this and why it matters. First, though, let's work our way through part of a GCM. In this case, the complete six-box climate model. Just kidding. It's sufficient to glance at the figure and appreciate some of the conceptual and programming challenges that have to be addressed. As I tell my students, this is not on the final exam. Now, one key aspect of climate models is the scale over which the data are collected and analyzed and presented. The grid on this map of North America, which, by the way, shows projected changes in humidity, is 300 to 400 kilometers on a side. Well, that doesn't allow for much detail or fine-tuning. The results will be much more generalized, much coarser, than if smaller boxes had been used, as they were in this map. Let's see, this one shows projected changes in extreme weather. So what matters here is the grid size, not what's being shown. The grid boxes here are just a few tens of kilometers on a side, so much more detail can be preserved and presented. Of course, the increased number of boxes means a huge increase in the raw number of data and a much larger computational challenge. As computer power and speed have increased, climate modelers have been able to tackle smaller and smaller grid boxes. In fact, the desire to process more climate data and to do it faster has helped stimulate fundamental developments in computing, particularly involving supercomputer clusters. Now, I debated omitting this slide, which may involve more of the nitty-gritty of modeling than you care about. If that's the case, just tune out, do something else until the next slide. Grid boxes in many global climate models are 10 to 100 kilometers across, but that's still far larger than many of the elements of the climate system. For example, a cumulus cloud is less than a kilometer across, and the equations describing winds and other relevant processes within a cloud operate over much smaller distances. Well, GCMs can't handle small features like clouds directly, so they use parameterizations, simplified processes that are sufficiently accurate substitutes or proxies for actual finer scale features and processes. Parameterizations are constantly being refined to produce more sophisticated, inclusive, and accurate representations of climate. This refinement, plus the inclusion of more components, the decrease of grid box size, and other programming improvements, have resulted in impressive increases in the usefulness and accuracy of global climate models. No, the models aren't perfect yet, and they never will be. Pundits who claim that climate modeling is futile because the models aren't perfect are merely demonstrating their own misunderstanding of how models are used, and the fact of how science works. Here's an example of how global climate models are tested prior to their use in projecting future climate. A viable model should be able to simulate the climate of the recent past. So we find a bunch of GCMs, which are produced by different research groups around the globe. We feed each model with the appropriate starting values, and we see if the models can simulate what actually happened in the 20th century. So this diagram shows 20th century temperatures as calculated by 58 simulations produced by 14 different GCMs. The 58 results are shown as a mass of superimposed yellow curves. The average of those 58 is the red line. The black line shows the temperature as it was actually recorded. First, it's clear that the differences among the simulations are minor. For instance, no yellow curves move from upper left to lower right. Second, the model average does a particularly good job of simulating the observed temperatures. Right? The red and the black lines follow each other. Third, all of the models and the model average are sensitive enough to detect the effects of major volcanic eruptions. Some of them are labeled here, Agung, El Chichon, and Pinatubo. Each of these cooled global temperature, but only for a year or two. So even over that small time scale, these models were able to pick them up. So if GCMs do such a good job with past climate, then we can feel at least guardedly confident about turning them loose on the climate of the future. This graph expands the simulation tests that we just talked about. In each graph, the black line shows the actual temperatures that were recorded in the 20th century, whether for a region like Europe or Africa, or in the bottom row, for all land surfaces, or all oceans, or the entire globe. In each graph, the blue band shows the results of 19 simulations from 5 GCMs that only used natural forcings to predict what the temperatures were in the 20th century. Human-caused changes were explicitly eliminated from these tests so that we could have a natural effects-only baseline. The pink band shows the results of 58 simulations from 14 GCMs that used not only natural forcings, but also anthropogenic forcings, in other words, human-induced changes. Well, what can we infer from these experiments? Here I've selected 3 of the 9 graphs, but any of them could have been used. Which of these 7 statements is supported by the experiments? More than one answer may be correct. So what I want you to do here is pause me and just on a sheet of paper or whatever, jot down the numbers of these, which of the 7 here are supported by the experiments that we just discussed. So pause me and don't restart until you've decided. The experiments support statements 2, 3, and 6. Statement 1 is not true. Human factors didn't make much of a difference from 1900 to 1950. The observed curves are tracked well by the blue all-natural bands, so statement 2 is true. But from 1950 to 2000, the blue all-natural band doesn't cut it. Only by adding the human impacts, which are included in the pink band, do the simulations track the observations. Thus, statement 3 is true, but statement 4 is not. So, for climate models to tell us anything about the future climate that's useful, they must account for both natural and anthropogenic forcings. Thus, statement 6 is true, and statements 5 and 7 are not. This diagram examines the effects of various factors on Earth's temperature over the last 1,000 years. Units on the vertical axis are in watts per meter squared and are referred to as forcings. The top part of the diagram shows the impact of volcanic eruptions on temperature. Note that four different curves are included and that they very nearly lay on top of one another. Now, we talked about these data, I talked about them in an earlier episode, episode 14. The ash and aerosols from eruptions produce a sharp drop in temperature because so much radiation is reflected back into space. But the effect is temporary. Within a few years, the ash and the aerosols settle down out of the atmosphere into the Earth's surface or into the oceans, and the climate stabilizes. The middle part of the diagram shows several tightly grouped estimates of the impact of variable solar output on Earth's climate. Over the last 1,000 years, the sun has had a roughly constant effect, with century-long rises and falls more or less averaging out. The bottom part of the diagram includes all other forcings, chiefly the concentration of greenhouse gases in the atmosphere. These forcings had negligible impact on climate until the early 1800s, but they really took off, especially in the second half of the 20th century, starting around the year 1950, corresponding with major post-World War II accelerations in many human activities, population growth, industrialized agriculture, gasoline and diesel consumption, deforestation, and a whole lot more. No serious climate scientist doubts that human activities are major influences on modern climate. Currently, global climate models are constructed so that stable climates are the only possible outcome of their experimental runs. And here, stable refers to the meaning we discussed in episode 4. If some factor changes, well, negative feedbacks will counter the effects of some disturbance and limit the climate change. However, as climate models incorporate more components and get more complex, previously unaccounted for feedbacks will develop, and the models may begin to predict complex, possibly chaotic climate behavior. In other words, an unstable climate. Earth's climate system may become so disturbed or disrupted that it crosses some threshold value that the models currently don't recognize, and beyond which predictable, stable behavior may not be possible. Such thresholds are referred to as tipping points. The stable future climates assumed by current climate models may not be appropriate, and future climate changes may be much larger than those that are usually anticipated. That's the end of episode 21.
So I hope that from that YouTube video that you have an idea of just how complex these climate models can be and some of the challenges in terms of accounting for all constituents in the atmosphere that can help produce climate change. We're making good strides, but we've still got plenty of growth to come. Okay, let's talk briefly about climate change and feedback loops. I think it was in Chapter 3 we started talking about positive feedback and negative feedback to a particular system, or maybe that was Chapter 4 when we talked about Earth systems. But the atmosphere and its interactions with the ocean and land surfaces experience both positive and negative feedbacks. Some of the negative feedbacks with this interaction is that warm temperatures, so if we begin to warm the temperatures, they begin to warm the air, and this leads to increased evaporation of ocean surfaces, and evaporation leads to more cloud formation, which reflects more sunlight, which could cool the surface. So that is a situation where it would tend to stabilize the situation. Some positive feedback in terms of kind of a runaway type of climate effect is that the warm temperatures warm the air. That leads to increased evaporation, but instead of clouds forming, we would just have water vapor. And we know that water vapor is an extremely powerful greenhouse gas. So this would lead to an increase in water vapor, which would lead to an increase in even warmer temperatures, which would produce even more water vapor, which would tend to increase the temperatures even more. So it would be a runaway type impact in terms of what we call positive feedback. Now, no one doubts that greenhouse gases exist and affects the planet. Trying to figure out how this all fits together in terms of the relative importance of greenhouse gases in affecting climate. That's one of the questions that we talked about at the beginning of this module. And there is evidence that indicates that increases in CO2, methane, and temperature rise and fall together. Although there's an interesting video that you will see probably next week, talks about the global warming hoax, where they debate that particular issue of greenhouse gases and temperatures rising and falling together. But most scientists do conclude that greenhouse gases are causing a climate change. That part they do agree on. In terms of the new understanding of the interplay between oceans and the atmosphere, the natural oscillations of the ocean are linked to the atmosphere. So as the ocean changes in terms of the heat energy stored and received, the ocean and the atmosphere are actually tied together. And in fact, a lot of these climate models, most climate models today, run what we call coupled models, whereas they look at the impacts of the ocean and the atmosphere. And in fact, the effect of the oscillations can be 10 times as strong as long-term warming that has been observed over the past century, larger even over a period of a few decades than human-induced climate change. Now, the climate system is driven, we talk about this coupled system between the atmosphere and the ocean, but it's driven in part by this thing we call the ocean conveyor belt. And it is a conveyor belt, or it's a movement of water throughout portions of the globe. And in fact, I've got a nice YouTube video here that explains that. But what we see here is warmer surface water, and the blue is the colder, more salty type water. So the increased salt leads to density, changes in density, which helps to have this cold water pool sink to the bottom. And so this difference in temperatures and difference in density of the water helps to create a transportation or a movement, a transport of energy, energy from the water, warm surface or shallow waters transferring moisture and heat up to northern latitudes, especially over Great Britain, and then sinking back down and moving along the ocean surface. But this YouTube video will do a nice job of explaining that.
The ocean conveyor belt and the Gulf Stream. Ocean currents have a direct influence on our lives. They determine our weather, our climate, and much more. The ocean currents and wind systems transport heat from the equator to the poles and operate like a large engine for the global climate. In the oceans, there are numerous currents. The so-called ocean conveyor belt is very important for our climate. This term describes a combination of currents that result in four of the five global oceans exchanging water with each other. They form a worldwide circulation system. The conveyor belt is also called the thermohaline circulation, with thermo referring to the temperature and haline to the salt content of the water. Both determine the density of the water. While the masses of water may be moved in part by wind, primarily the different densities of the global oceans are responsible for their movement. Warm water has a lower density and rises, while cold water sinks. The water's density also increases with a higher salt content. At the equator, the heat from the sun is especially strong, resulting in a lot of evaporation and thus a rise in the water's salt content. That is where the Gulf Stream begins. The Gulf Stream is very important for the European climate. Its length of 10,000 kilometers makes it one of the largest and fastest ocean currents on Earth, and it's very warm. At roughly 2 meters a second, it brings up to 100 million cubic meters of water per second towards Europe. A constantly blowing wind, the southeast trade wind, drives warm surface water to the northwest into the Gulf of Mexico, where it heats up to 30 degrees Celsius. The turning of the earth and the west winds then direct the Gulf Stream towards Europe and split it up. One part flows south, another east to the Canary Current, and a third part flows north, where it releases a lot of heat into the atmosphere as the North Atlantic Current. The water becomes colder there. Its salt content and density rise on account of evaporation, and it drops down between Greenland, Norway, and Iceland. There we also find the largest waterfall on Earth, the so-called Chimneys, roughly 15-kilometer wide pillars with water falling up to 4,000 meters. 17 million cubic meters of water per second, or roughly 15 times more water than is carried by all the rivers in the world. This creates a strong maelstrom which constantly pulls in new water and is the reason that the Gulf Stream moves towards Europe. Countless species use the Gulf Stream as a means of transport on their trips from the Caribbean to northern areas. But it doesn't just bring us animals. An enormous quantity of warm air also comes with it. In order to produce the same heat which it brings to the shores of Europe, we would need 1 million nuclear power plants. That's why we also call the Gulf Stream a heat pump. Without it, the temperature would be significantly colder here, at least 5 to 10 degrees. Instead of lush fields, we would have long winters and sparse ice-covered landscapes in Europe. In the last few years, scientists and pundits in the media have repeatedly expressed the fear that the Gulf Stream could come to a standstill due to climate change. Because if the polar caps actually melt, the salt content in the water off Greenland would fall, as would its density. The North Atlantic Current would no longer be heavy enough, and so it wouldn't sink as usual. In the worst case, that would bring the Gulf Stream, our heat pump, to a stop. Some climate experts also assume that climate change could compensate for this effect. We know that it can be normal for the climate to change by looking at the development of the Earth over the last few million years. There are ice ages and warm periods. In the last ice age, a gigantic flood of melting water crippled the heat-bringing North Atlantic Current, covering the northern hemisphere in ice. Scientists have different views on the impact that climate change will have on the global ocean conveyor belt. But one thing is clear, when the climate changes, then the complex system of ocean currents and winds, which has remained fairly stable since the last ice age, will change in ways that we don't yet understand.